Very exciting day. Election day. So.
Precursor to your birthday.
And that's what we have some goodies. We have some goodies for the birthday party today.
So, we should start with public comments, introductions, special guests, which I think we'll have anything. It's like October 11th. We just put the minutes, so I'm sure you all read it when you got it in the mail.
I am on
the phone. Everybody, Adam is in on the phone. So, hi Adam.
Hi, how are you?
Hi Adam. All
right, get me with you in person.
Yeah. We need that. We need to see Adam here.
Yeah, I'm hosting an event for the election.
Yeah.
Any other day, I'll do
it. All right, awesome. Looking forward to that.
Absolutely.
So, we need a motion for this. So, we need a motion for this. So, we need a minute. Do you have a second for that?
2 seconds.
2 seconds? Okay, very well. So, are we all in favor? Is anybody staying? Is anybody...
I'm just going to say if it wasn't there.
Okay, all right. Very well. Somebody else in favor? Let's go to the treasurer report.
We have two things we need to talk about today. One is just the current state of our finances, which are fine. We have the report that takes us through October 31st in front of you there. You can see that we are continuing to track on par with our budget. We're expecting to end the year, according to Jose, who's our accountant, it's about $170,000 in the bank that we are expecting to end the year with this year. We have not spent any other money out of the old bid account. We did have a motion last month to spend $18,000 out of that account for the wayfinding signage design program, half of which was coming out of, it's $36,000 total, half of which 18 was coming out of the current year's budget out of beautification, and the other 18 was coming out of old bid account. So that money will be probably deducted more than likely after next month once we receive an invoice from Wayne. The other part of our financial report today is the 2017 draft budget. And so this is the annual process that we go through each year to prepare our budget for the city. It's due December 1st, so we have to have it approved in our November meeting. In front of you, you have a planning report. This is just kind of the narrative of what the numbers are that I'm about to show you. You can spend some time later if you like looking at it. The reason why it's highlighted in yellow is that this is the draft, and based off what you choose today, those numbers may change, and so we might update that before we submit. But long story short, that's the narrative, and then the large sheets are the actual budget. So just looking at that, I have in front of you, and I'm sorry for the plethora of paperwork that you have in front of you today, but there's three scenarios that we're considering. If you look at the top page up in the right corner, highlighted there, it should say version one. What this is just walking us through what a proposed budget would be for next year. This is very similar to the draft budget that was prepared and shown at last month's meeting for those of you who were here. We estimate that our down on the bottom line there where it says B2 in the green box, our projected year-end cash on hand is around $994,000. And that's slightly higher than the report that you just saw. The reason for that is we are expecting to be under budget in a number of categories, and you can see that in the expected variance column there on the right for the current year's budget. And that's where that difference is coming in from. The reason being is Jose, our accountant, when he does his budget that you saw earlier, he builds it out assuming that we're gonna spend everything down. And we on staff always have a better sense of what that will actually truly be. And so that's why there's a difference there. What we've always proposed and what we will continue to do is take a portion of that year-end cash on hand and roll it into next year's budget. And then we keep about this year, it'll be half of that for the final year remaining in the bid, which is 2018. And so that gives us money to build out that budget. We always have this because for two reasons. One is that it helps kind of supplement our assessment dollars and gives us some extra money to work with in the coming year. And the second is that we usually typically do not receive our city assessments until February or March of each year. So we have some cash to go into next year with, so we don't have to get a line of credit. And that's part of the reason why we always kind of try to build in for a rollover of year end cash on hand. So the far right column is a 2017 proposed budget. There's not a lot in there that has changed. Security was slightly increased in this scenario. We kept our maintenance budget the same. Even though our new contract is less, was anticipated to be around $75,000 in savings next year with our new vendor. And with that savings, Matthew, we'll talk about that briefly later, but the Streetscape Committee is going to look at how we can increase programming out there with that $75,000 in savings. So rather than decrease our budget next year in maintenance, we decided to keep it the same if the board so chooses. And that way we have some money, extra money to work with maintenance next year. Beautification, there was a slight increase of about $5,000. Matthew and the committee have done a tremendous job this year spending that on various projects, and I think they want to continue to do that. Marketing, we increased it by $5,000 in the event that we are able to participate in the Music and Arts Festival that is moving forward next year. Management contract was another increased expense. It was about 3%, and the reason for that is we have a 3% increase in our rent annually here, so that was just to account for that increase. And then we increased consulting, which is a large chunk of that increase on that line item of district management, by about 20 grand. And the reason for that is we are getting ready for bid renewal. We need to hire a consultant. We have a proposal from a consultant we would like to move forward with. It's about 50 grand for this, for the work that he will be doing for us. And we are splitting that over the remaining 2 years. So half of that will be paid out of next year's budget. And that's why we increased that line item there. Everything else has stayed pretty much true to form. We have our traditional city fee in there. Contingency, we kept at 5% because that's where we're at right now, year to date. There's about $26,000 in private assessments that we're waiting to receive. But again, those may not be paid, you know, in the immediate future. But that being said, we're around 5% now. So we kept it at 5% next year. And then our contingency, we increased slightly to 16,500 from 11,000.
Quick question.
Sure.
So with all this new square footage online, mm-hmm. like Camden, Columbus Square, that's all built in?
So Columbus Square was not included yet because they didn't have their certificate of occupancy when we submitted the roll. So that will be on next year's assessment roll. Camden's actually not in your bid. It's actually in the Hollywood bid.
Oh, right. Okay.
And then the only one that was added to this was, there's two things. If you look at this number up here on the far right, under 2016-17 assessments, it's about 1.54 million. On the far left for this past year, it was 1.52. The difference in there is two things. One is that we approved in May a 1.7% CPI increase to our assessments this year. And the other is that we had a certificate of occupancy for Emerson. So thank you, Joyce. We had some extra money coming in from that. But next year we should see Columbia Square on there. We should have a reflection of their increased square and our assessment being good. So that's the first scenario. The other thing, the other two are pretty brief. There's not much difference. But here's the thing that we wanted to talk to you about. We, Carrie and I, met with Andrews International, Steve and James, who's our account rep, and our officers. And the company in our contract has not received an increase since 2013 when we bid it out. And they've had no CPI increase or any form of increase in that contract. And so they came forward with a proposal asking for a 5% increase to see if we can increase their contract by 5% to help give the officers a raise and pay for some other programming potentially. And I took that into consideration. So that's why it's before you today. I met with Fabio yesterday to go over these numbers, and he suggested, let me walk you through it first. So if you look at the third sheet, which is version 3, in the top left there, highlighted, the only difference that you'll see is the highlight on the left, we went to 840,000, that reflects a 5% increase in the security contract. The difference, and what, so how does that play out for us? The difference is if you look down at the bottom for our year-end cash on hand, we would roll over $113,000, which leaves us with about $80,000 for the remaining year of the bid. It's not a lot, but if we keep our numbers where they're at now, we would have a little bit of a deficit unless we got some extra income from these projects that Brett was talking about, or we had some past due assessments that we received. Or raise the assessment again by CPI next year. So we would just potentially be in a tight spot. The other thing is, in order to accommodate this, I took the liberty of keeping our beautification and marketing budget, which is highlighted in green there on the right, to the same number as it is this year, just so we can have more money to hopefully roll over for the remaining year. So that's the 5%. In talking with Fabio yesterday, he suggested we do a 3% for the sake of having, or at least propose a 3% for the sake of having some extra money and at least sleeping a little easier knowing that we have that cash on hand for 2018. So that's version two there. And it's about $24,000 more we would be able to give to security. And that leaves us with $96,434 remaining for 2018, which is similar to version one. Again, to keep those numbers in line, I took the liberty of keeping the beautification, the marketing budget the same, and I lowered the contingency from what was proposed in version one from $16,000 to $12,000.
Joe, how about giving them the 5%, but asking them to increase their services to a certain, for 2% of it? So 3% would be their increase in whatever it is that they're asking for an increase in, and then 2% would be more services. Security is right now our biggest issue.
So one thing that we talked about was, in that, under that scenario, we would have $24,000 to give towards raises and everything else that they would have. And then that would leave us $16,000 at 2% to do something with. Carrie has been working, and Steve has been working on this idea, and we're in a trial period right now of having a dedicated outreach worker for homelessness in the bids. We, right now, we have great partnerships with a lot of our service providers in the area, but nobody is doing dedicated outreach really in this area, which is a loss for us because we start to not know and build relationships with the folks who are out there right now on the streets, which is something that we've gotten very good at and we enjoy doing, and it's part of our function here. So to Carol's point, that's definitely a potential. We're, like I said, this is, right now is an experiment, but if we find that this is successful, we can continue that on in the new year, and maybe that 2% goes towards paying for that position.
Yeah, it could be something, this ambassador could be somebody that would give us more of an idea of
good presence.
What is going on the street, so we can really better assess where we need to be.
And does the Henders contract allow us to say we want increased services, or how does it work with the raises, for example? Is it just a mutually agreeable?
Yes, so as far as the position, it would be probably a change order that we'd do to the contract to add that position in. But as in terms of the raises, that's their prerogative, right?
Yeah. I mean, we're not gonna dictate
right.
Who or how much. It gives them the ability to, if it's a 5% bump, they could raise some people 7 and others 2 or whatever. One of the things that Steve shared, which was interesting, because it is, it's important for Steve to be able to recruit quality people. This is not the kind of gig that you want to get, the lowest possible, cost officer. And so they're competing right now. The rate for our guys is $31.50 an hour. The Dodgers are paying $35 and $40 an hour. Pantages pays $35 an hour. Marshalls pays $34 an hour. The Rams pay $36. And so we're competing, we're kind of below the market with respect to some of these other entities that will seek armed officers. And, he's got to be able to be competitive to get quality people on board. So they made the case pretty compelling.
And the the studios like Sunset Gower, Sunset Tribune, that you guys use Andrews?
Yep.
And is the rate pretty competitive? Okay.
So, to Carol's point, we could do the 5%, you know, that leaves us about 80 grand for 2018. And we can hope that if CPI or Columbia Square can add that $30,000 deficit. We also, like I said, we have $26,000 pending in accounts receivable right now.
For Icon, when is the certificate of occupancy for Icon?
2017.
By June 1st?
Probably.
Maybe.
Okay. Thank you, Bill. So that's the scenarios there. So there's two motions. One is to accept the financial report for the month, and then the other would be to approve our planning report and budget for 2017. So I can submit it to the city.
Okay. I have another question.
Sure.
Before we go.
Yeah.
There was a gentleman here from Andrews who was doing sort of the street, like the ambassador type job.
Right, that's our trial.
But that was just a trial.
It's right. Currently a trial program, yes.
Yeah.
Are we paying for the trial?
Mm-hmm.
It's being absorbed in the existing budget. They always leave a certain wiggle room in their patrol budget for exigencies that might occur or whatever, and so it's within the current.
But I do like the idea of adding that ambassador.
Yeah.
And I think it's a critical part of the communication of what's going on the street and the, dealing with lots of other issues we have on the streets. I think it's important. So
yeah, we also talked.
What we're saying though is no way to like absorb that into the 2017.
Well, we did talk with the Andrews team last week about. I personally would be willing to see some of our our armed officers' hours curtailed. This is actually not the most important thing. It's a very important thing right now because we have so many people out there that need to be engaged, and it's not the best use of our guys' time, nor are they particularly effective when they're in uniform. So I think Steve and I'll let you finish the sentence, Steve, but they would be willing to work with us if we couldn't do the full 5% and we wanted to do the dedicated homeless outreach person in 2017, and if we had to cut back on some of the patrol hours, there'd be a way to do that.
Yeah, as far as I'm concerned, everything's on the table. I work for you, so right now I have extra funds because I made a commitment to you guys, blasted to the Hollywood bid. We would save some hours for a possible nighttime patrol, and I didn't know if it was going to affect down here too, so I didn't fill some shifts. Guys called sick. We went short so we could save that money. And now we're going to be using some of that on this outreach guy. He's been very effective. His name's Max. He was a corpsman, Navy, signed with the Marines in Afghanistan. First thing I did was give him a trauma pack that we have that we don't really know how to use. So if somebody gets shot or knifed, we got him right on the scene. He was out for a couple of weeks and already made maybe 12 contacts. And he's getting kind of in-depth information, which we can supply to Carrie and the outreach people. So once again, we can fine-tune how do we address the problems instead of spinning wheels. Who is this guy? Why is he here? What's his needs? And this guy's gung-ho. He's very impressed with him so far. And the main thing for us is to keep a structure for him. So he's going to be...
If there's a way to reallocate resources to make it happen,
mm-hmm.
Yeah, we will do that.
Was he on foot by any chance? Was he walking up and down?
Yeah, I had him walking with my unarmed officers to start. I'm not going to put him out alone.
I know, yeah.
You know, it's just...
And is he going to probably need a car if we do take that position on? Is he going to need some sort of a...
No, you know, he's going to be with someone, you know, have a sergeant drop him off. He'll, you know, we'll do whatever we have to do. The outreach community has really embraced us on this. I've already brought him to meetings, to HOD meeting, and afterwards I had to drag him out of there because we had to be somewhere else, but he's already making contacts. And what's your number? And, you got a real flair for this. I'm real happy with him so far.
Okay. I just wanted to make
sure. Is he still working? Is he still?
He's handling some personal issues right now, but he should be back any day. Be with
I wasn't trying to go over a tangent, but I was reviewing it in relation to this budget.
Right. If we can't do the full 5%, we can fiddle with hours. We can make it all work.
I've already cut our unarmed ambassadors 2 days a week. You know, 32 hours. Just to make more room for this, so we're willing to compromise.
Hollywood has more wiggle room than Sunset because it's a more robust security budget.
And we also have public safety officers and other things that we have. There's room.
And it might be what we have to do is his time in the Sunset bid might be a 20-80 or something. You know, depending on how the budget works out. What happens, Joe, if Hollywood approves a full 5% increase and they do the 3%?
haven't played that out yet.
I mean, Hollywood would get a little more service than Sunset Vine would just have to parse out. You know, how much dollars we contribute, how many dollars they contribute, and just ours.
So I guess it's fair to say that if their last increase was for the calendar year 2013, so that's 14, 15, 16, the new increase takes effective January of 2017, so that's on average and retroactively 1% per year, right?
At 3%, yeah.
At 3%, it'd be a little bit more than that.
I mean, personally, it's your decision as a board. I would recommend the 5%, but it's whatever you feel comfortable with.
I would recommend 5% too.
Me too. And how close are we cutting it if we do the 5% again?
It's about a $30,000 shortfall, if you want to call it that, for 2018 compared to what you tucked away for 17. So it's 113,000 versus 80,000.
You have to make that up someplace. It's
You could do a slight CPI increase next year if you're feeling pretty good about bid renewal and you just got to get through the final year. You have that option.
And the thing, the way that our management district plan is written, is that CPI is CPI, 3%, whichever is less. So you can always do less.
And what CPI or what increase are you going to do?
It's on March to March calendar. So in March of 2017, I'll run the number based off the table and then I'll calculate what it is and I'll let us know. But we won't know until March of 2017.
Last year,
1.7 was what we did.
I don't have a problem with increasing the budget, but I would also like to see more increased services also. So if that's something we can consider and negotiate with families.
Well, if we do the 5% thing, we have maybe two guys, like max, because I think, you know, this one for Shunting, one for Hollywood, it's a big area.
From what I'm understanding is they want the CPI increase for the current officers, but if we want to add any more services, right? We would have to pay.
That's kind of the discussion you're having about the new bid.
This CPI increase of 5%, we're just talking about current existing officers who deserve to get their raise.
But we could also say, well, we want some increased service a little bit.
Okay.
A little bit. As well as, well, it's never awkward.
Yeah.
That's a negotiation.
I only came up with the 3% more raises because we were talking, it had been brought up, hey, let's keep it at 3 instead of 5. And I thought, let's do 5.
I agree to a 3% increase. I agree to a 3% increase and 2% if we can get the increase in budget and have them give us a maybe peace officer, maybe someone walking the streets, maybe a little golf cart driving around, some different options.
Well, I think all we can say is we're going to give you a 5% increase, but we expect this much extra services. And then they decide what they do with that 3%.
Yeah, with the outreach worker, I think that's where a lot of our, you know, property owner complaints are right now. So we got a dedicated person we can send out there. That's gonna look like increased service.
Yeah, I would agree to that then. Yeah.
But is the increase also including the increase in wages?
My understanding was basically this is the covered increase in wages.
Yes.
The full 5%.
You're doing better than I'm doing.
Well, they haven't since 2000.
It's been a while. It's been a long time.
Yeah. So that's why maybe.
My increases are much higher. There's a union, certain union wages.
Well, that's what you're saying.
But if we were to do a 5% increase in the Andrews contract and then say, okay, we also want X amount of service increase, 1%, 2%, you do with the balance what you want because we can't dictate how they spend the dividends.
You get a pretty good deal, is what I'm saying.
That kind of sounds like you're almost asking cut back on something to pay for the outreach worker. At the same time, this can be some complicated math.
That's what I was trying to get to. I feel like this increase is strictly for the CPI increase that they want. And any additional services, maybe we're going to have to come back because later. So in that case, maybe we could just go with the 3% now and then ask for additional services.
Well, we're kind of, you know, getting ready for the new year, and Hollywood's going to be considering this next week as well. So, if we can get the intent of your motion is, it sounds like leaning toward a 5% increase, but expecting some documentable or tangible service increase that will go along with it. Which, the way I'm reading that is that we find a way to fully fund a full-time outreach worker who is, you know, at our beck and call, which means that we're gonna have to trim some of the patrol hours to do that. And that's gonna be the person who's responding to the specific need to help us.
Cut down on the patrol hours.
Well, I don't know how we squeeze more patrol. I mean, that, you know, with.
We might have to just do like a separate change order as mentioned earlier.
Describe what the current team is for Sunset, the manpower. It's one and a half cars?
Well, there's two 6 a.m. officers and two that come on at noon throughout the week, including Sunday. Now we actually have a 6 a.m. car we never used to. And then we have extra officers floating in and out between there, here and there, wherever we feel a need. And it might be a Wednesday, we have something going and we'll have an extra car, or just as it goes. But there's always the four guys spread through the day, and they're backed up by the Hollywood cars.
And how many are in Hollywood?
Two 6 a.m., a sergeant who could be either assigned to Sunset or Hollywood that day at 6. So there's five officers in the morning total. I kind of look at it as the two, because the two support each other. And then oftentimes we'll have a bike team or something come on at 10, and then two or three teams at noon, including a sergeant.
One of the things we've been bringing up in starting the bid renewal discussions is that we really do feel Sunset needs more resources. Because it's the same physical size with far less security.
Carrie, is there a way to quantify sources of additional revenue, not guaranteed, but just sort of corral those, so we have as a board some picture of, okay, if we do this and we do this and this, we can expect X thousands of dollars of additional revenue, right? And at least that way we have a complete picture.
We have what we anticipate with Columbia Square, which we can figure. It's not going to be huge because our building square footage is our least heavy.
But something, I mean, so as a board, we can at least have a sense of
what that
where
looks
the
like.
Dollars might be coming in.
And then Icon, which, you know, and then we can look at what a 0.5% or 1% CPI might generate next year to get you. So we could bring that to the next meeting? Or,
That'd be helpful.
Okay.
We still have to make a motion later today to accept the budget. So
the budget will.
So we have to decide what
which
version, for example.
Right, and I mean, you could even create your own version if you wanted to do more than 5% or less than, I mean, these are just kind of round numbers for you to mull over, but I'm just going out there. We need a motion today because I have to have it into the city by December 1st.
So I just wonder from Andrew's point of view, is 5% really enough to hit? Is 3% doable, in your opinion?
Anything to help. Personally, I would rather have fewer quality officers than get a bunch of officers. The quality of our officers is what it makes us effective and keeps all of us in this room out of trouble. And that's why I'm losing people right now. I'm kind of hemorrhaging them. I just lost another full-time guy. He's going off to work at a hospital somewhere because he gets medical benefits. So that's what I'm trying to stop this. Great, I'm recruiting nonstop. Every time I hire someone, my fear is they're gonna walk up at the front door and go, "Wee-hee, I got a gun." You know, they could get in a shooting. We just had incident one in my report where it could have been another shooting. But so I want well-trained guys. So 3% is a lot better than what I got now.
Is your feeling 5% is really lean?
It's a nice round number. My VP just kind of threw it out there. We didn't know what to expect, if it was doable or not. But we had this, you know, it's a starting point.
I'm just talking about recruitment of good people, retention of good people.
Yeah, I think it puts us in the ballpark for a while.
It doesn't even bring you to the rate that these other entities are.
You know what it does is it shows them something substantial, and then I would use it as a tool. I wouldn't give it. Right now we have a structure. Everyone gets the same pay. This would be more merit-based, so I could use it to motivate them. New guys will come in at a lower rate, and the guys that we have will get recognized. It'll give them incentive, something to work towards, and give me another tool.
All right.
Okay, I'd like to make a motion to increase the security budget by 5%.
We'll just accept the total budget with the 5% increase to security. That would be the motion.
Okay.
I'll second that.
I think 5% makes everybody happy.
So we have four on that.
Yes, we have, yeah, seems like it. I mean, I think we kind of hope to have an unhappy security provider.
So.
What do you think?
So the motion is to approve the 2017 proposed budget and planning report with a 5% increase to the security line.
Are two different ones, or?
No, that's just one motion.
Just one motion.
And that's by Brian, seconded by Carol.
Okay, so is everybody in favor with a 5% increase in the budget?
Yeah.
Nobody, you know, against or abstaining?
And then we need a motion for the October.
Financial statements. Alright, so do I have somebody to move the financial statement for October 2016? Okay, Joyce, you got it? So is everybody in favor with that? Awesome, like abstain, should we move on to new business?
Yeah, one more. Insurance policy, just real quick.
Insurance policy.
We've been following this saga. I finally got an email back from our insurance broker after hounding them yesterday. I guess the delay was because they received several changes amending our policy. For those of you who don't remember, we had a difference that we had to pay because they had our old address on the policy, so we were paying for two coverages. We should have only had one, so they went back. So there's three endorsements that were processed, and we have return premiums of $320 for removing our business personal property, $497 coming back from deleting the Vine Street location, and $741 coming back, which is fixing the area of the new location and correcting the payroll. They had the wrong payroll number in there. So it's about $1,500 that we should be receiving back. So that's good news. So that's all I had to say on that.
So that thing is over?
It's pretty much over. We just need to get the check. So that's why I had it.
All right, so now we have one new business then.
David.
Man.
Stella.
So we had five applicants, all incumbents for the positions that are rolling this year. We didn't have any new candidates apply. So the nominating committee has concluded all of the interviews this week, and we're set to deploy this slate next week.
Yeah, next Friday we'll be mailing it out to the property owners.
Okay. That's it, that's all I got.
Okay, sure. All right, and now we have an update, the new working group. Mr. Falk, would you please enlighten us?
My pleasure. So we met, our ad hoc committee met for both bids back on November 8th, Tuesday. Oh no, we met last week. What was the date that we
met?
November 1st. So we have just did a general overview, reviewed the timeline for the renewal. We reviewed a list of assessment payers from highest to least to get a sense of what it would take to get our 50% plus one. We reviewed the consulting proposal from Urban Place and agreed to proceed with this consultant. Both bids will set aside $46,000 each, and this cost can be spread over 2017 and 18. We'll have this motion on the December board meeting as an action item. We approved sending out an RFP for six economic consultants to do an economic analysis documenting the impact of the two bids. We will look at such things as tax revenues generated by the bid, occupancy rates, hotels and residential, office market trends and commercial lease rates, changes in assessed values, retail rents, many other aspects. And they'll bring these proposals back to the board in December or January. We had a robust discussion on the potential boundaries. There are some opportunity for the Sunset bid to go northeast towards the Highland Quadrant, inclusion of Coal and Fountain parcels. We're going to go on a tour on November 16th at 9:30 to take a closer look at what these potential boundary changes would be. We're also looking at putting together face-to-face meetings with potential new bid areas for Crossroads, the Crossroads Project, Musicians Institute, and Fountain Coal. That's my report.
We will have that proposal that Brian mentioned from the consultant at our December meeting for approval. Okay, so you'll vote for that.
Joe, since you're near the map and that is left over from last week's meeting, you might want to show the area that's under consideration for expansion to see if any board members have any contacts, because we do need to meet some of these people to see what they would feel like.
It's this pink box right here. So it's Highland Avenue, roughly to Casile, Seward on the south, Sunset Boulevard, and to Selma. And along the south side of Sunset, it would just be the first commercial parcel in it. So this line, this pink line, is deceiving. It should actually come up to about here.
So that's Musicians Institute.
Musicians Institute is all this.
So that's Beth.
Yeah.
Yep, that's Beth.
Crossroads is in there.
Crossroads is all this.
Anything going on here?
With that Foster? He's not
included.
That's already included.
Oh, it's already included.
It's already in. Yeah, so it's only this pink box here.
And then the other area is the Fountain and Coal project.
Yeah, which is down here across from the fire station and LAPD down there. This is Cal Coast and those guys that are building this. It's the large apartment structure there. They're vacating the street and then building over the entire parcel where they did assemblage.
That will be Sunset and Vine Bay.
Yeah, that's this is up for consideration. Is what Brian, like Brian said. Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Hey, first of all, I wanted to thank Fred. We've had an ongoing problem with our radio communications. There's a lot of complicated things going on up in the higher levels here. And I wish we would have talked to you earlier, but you know, the company comes out, they tell me they're like speaking in Latin, I don't know what they're talking about. So I'm kind of at their mercy. Fred kind of acted as our interpreter, even climbed up to the roof of the W and found out where we should put antennas and all kinds of stuff, better batteries, so I do thank you.
Good job.
He insisted on taking the stairway up to the top instead of the elevator.
Did you put a hitch on him or have him sign a waiver?
I made that part up, but he did help us a lot. Appreciate it.
Thanks, Fred.
This report takes us through week 43. The only interesting trend is our calls for service are up very slightly, I mean less than 20, but last year was a record pace, but maybe we bottomed out, you know, finally. I don't know. So far this year, we're just on the same pace, a little bit over, so that's a good thing. Some of the interesting incidents, on October 4th, we had a female transient blocking traffic at Selma and Vine. She went out into traffic, tried to open the door to a car, but it stopped at the red light, driver rolled the windows, locked the doors, and we actually just had to go up and tell her, hey, get out of the street, and she took off. But you know, it's kind of a frightening thing. And these are the examples of people that are walking around out here. You know, it's frightening. You don't want to see that. That same day, we were conducting a business check at a local restaurant, which I won't name. It's at 1413 Vine, and I once saw Ronald McDonald there. But there was a guy laying in the walkway.
Not anymore.
And you guys asked him to get up. He jumped up. He's shouting profanities. They notice he has a knife in his waistband. They tell him to get up, they kind of back off a little bit. He takes an orange juice and douses one of our officers' leg with it. And basically we talked, calmed him down, and got him to leave. This is a guy that needs to be arrested in my estimation. However, we realize the reality is he's just gonna get a citation. And it's, you know, they're not taking guys like this into custody, but he's a danger to everyone. And these are the people we're gonna try to impact more and more with our outreach worker. Who is this guy? What can we do for him? He obviously needs help, and he's a danger to all of us. We talked about a little bit about our new outreach worker. He's attended meetings already. As I said, he's been embraced. The center has offered us desk space for him over at the church. That's important because we don't want to bring a homeless person that's already scared of authority into our armed office, into those environments. Now he has a place where he can meet them off to the side and have direct access. My friend's place and others have offered training for him, and I'm kind of pairing an armed officer with him who's going to some of the meetings too, so we have a little bit of a team building there. And if we could get our own separate one down here, I think it'd be fantastic. They could complement each other, and that's definitely a goal. This is a pilot, and we hope to see, we'll take this as far as it can go. On the 28th, down at the bottom of the page, Housing Works came to the bid at 3 a.m, along with the LA Times, with the film crew, and they were going to try to document some of our 14 most vulnerable people. I happened to have a team on that night at 2 a.m. We were doing our end of the month homeless count, so we paired up with them. We actually found one of the people they were looking for them. We found several encampments for them to film if they so desired. So we got a lot of thank yous from Housing Works for helping to coordinate that with them. Meetings attended, my staff and I attended 15 meetings, and it's the usual law enforcement, business community, and homeless outreach community as we, you know, represent you and pool resources. Outreach, of course, is one of our problem-solving roles. A couple of the stories: on October 5th, we found a man down at 6450 Sunset. Leg was badly swollen, couldn't get up, called paramedics, and they took him to the hospital. And that's often the last we'll hear of this guy, but he's obviously needs treatment. There's a lot of people like that falling between the cracks. We've got literally thousands of those cases. On October 6th, our new outreach worker spoke to a man named Josh. He had already met him on the street previously. Josh is well-spoken, respectful. He draws attention. He's a very large man. He sits on the bus bench, and he makes little pouches, and he gives them away for free. But he's very intelligent, and kind of that's half the battle. He's not psychotic or deranged. He can communicate. He just has a fear. He's too proud to ask for help, in the opinion of our guy, and he's fallen through the cracks. But we can work with him. I think, you know, with our outreach guy who has a really good rapport, could maybe bring this guy in, and we'll hopefully get him off the street. Our officer spoke to a guy named Marcel, and already our officers have figured out this is a resource, and that's how I sold it to our officers. They call over our max, our outreach worker. And he has more time to deal with that, and frees our other officers up to get back out on patrol. So Max talked to Marcel, learned he'd been homeless for over a year. He's from the LA area. He's not currently looking for work, and he actually sleeps on friends' couches on occasion. But these are the data we want to gain and figure out exactly who are our homeless people and what do they need to help them. Max has made several other contacts in the Hollywood bid as well. These are just a few examples, so we're going to see how far we can take this. On the 19th, we had called a woman needing assistance on a bus bench in front of 1400 Vine. Officers arrived. She was bleeding from a large gash on her forehead. Called paramedics. They treated her at the scene. She's 65 years old, homeless, hungry, and she would like a place to live, she said. So our officers took her across the street, bought her a meal at that same restaurant we talked about. The food was great, I heard. And they hooked her up with an outreach worker, so that was good. Enforcement, we've made 95 arrests so far, and all the other stats are there if you're interested. And onto the last page, I'm just going to cover one arrest that I found to be a little bit humorous. On October 23rd, our officer saw a man standing on the hood of a parked car. He had kicked in the windshield and then climbed inside the car. When our officers approached, he said, "It's okay, it's my girlfriend's car." We called LAPD, and we had him sit on the curb until LAPD arrived. The humorous part was when LAPD got there, we all found out it wasn't his girlfriend's car. It hit the wrong one. The owner of the car came out of his apartment. He was not abused in the least. And the man was arrested for felony car burglary. So it was kind of interesting. Our deployment remained the same, 6 a.m. to 8 p.m. Monday through Saturday, 6 a.m. to 6 p.m. Sunday. And during this period, our officers received training in bloodborne pathogens, report writing, live fire handgun training, and legal updates.
Thank you, Stephen. Awesome. Very good job. 85%.
I'm talking about the midnight walk, just briefly. Those of you that remember, we do this from time to time. We go out at midnight, so just look at conditions in the bid. And this was actually, it's a Hollywood walk, where we walk Hollywood Boulevard primarily, but I want to thank Fabio, who made the time to come out, even though it was your guys'
decision. I go for the beard.
Exactly. So we went out with the LAPD, and I will just tell you, it was very encouraging. Carrie and I had done this, what, about a year ago, maybe?
2 years ago.
2 years ago. It was the last time we were out there, when we were kind of in our heyday of nightclubs, where we had, you know, 80-something clubs here in our two districts, and a lot of those clubs have since gone away due to just the changing demographics. We have residents living here. It was before this was more, you know, kind of just a destination. Now it's becoming a neighborhood. And it was just great to see how things are moving in the right direction. You know, there's still a lot of people here at night. It's very diverse and active and fun. It's everything that we want it to be. And there's still work to be done, no doubt about it. But in those areas where changes have been made and where the council office has also done some work, like in the area of Hollywood Las Palmas, there was a drastic difference from how it was, and it was much safer and just it's an all around much more enjoyable experience.
I met a friend of mine that told me, yeah, and I saw him last night, and then I went to the hotel. And he was walking the boulevard, he said, it was fine, it had no bad feeling, nothing bad happened. We walked around, and then we saw him. So. But they said, no, I asked him, was it anything awkward? No, I said, we had a wonderful time. Good. It was like 1 o'clock in the morning. So that's really very encouraging.
So it's encouraging. I think LAPD, the council office, city attorney, everybody, I think, is just working hard.
And Mike is Mike Ling is really
He knows his stuff.
Motivated, doing an awesome job.
So we'll continue to monitor.
Let's go out on Friday night. Monitor. All right, so tomorrow morning we have a meeting. So we got Steve, we got Pat, we got Street Scale, we have Jay is not here, but we have Matt. Matt, please.
And we'll do your report out. Sure, so no action items this month, but we've got some project updates for you. We're moving forward with the wayfinding signage project. The Hollywood Board approved their portion of the expenses, so we got that contract signed with Wayne Hunt Design to move forward on that. At the direction of the board, we did send this letter to the chamber. It's the blue letter in your packet. Requesting funding assistance in the amount of $20,000 to support the project. So Carrie and I will be at that board meeting tomorrow to discuss this and see if they're able to help us pay for the design work.
We were going to talk to them about it, but Adaron had
Jury duty?
You have a meeting with him tomorrow?
It's a chamber board meeting.
Tomorrow afternoon?
Yeah.
So once we get their participation confirmed, we will begin with a series of meetings of about, I think we'll have about 5 meetings over a 2-month period with 6 to 8 stakeholders to help guide that work. And we did recently learn about another project that the county is working on in partnership with Metro. They're doing another signage project that's very similar to what we're trying to accomplish with ours. And they're proposing about 20 signs along Hollywood Boulevard in Highland to direct pedestrians to the Metro Red Line station. So we will be meeting with the county folks next week to see how we can collaborate. They're not too far along in the process, so I think that there is room to work together, and they do have funding to build that portion of the project. So I think that's a good thing. There is money to actually do some work on this. So we'll have an update next month to see how those conversations go, but we definitely think that they'll be looped into the work that we're doing.
Do you know if they hired the same designer, or is it like an in-house thing that they're doing?
Yeah, so from my knowledge, it's they're doing a lot of it in-house, but we're hoping essentially that they will simply adopt the design program that we create. But again, it'll be a conversation to see what they're willing to do.
And we are going to coordinate to get some sort of design concept while
Yeah, it's very serendipitous that we kind of heard about it because we saw pictures of what they wanted to do, which would not have been anything we would have approved.
Yeah, and it just doesn't make sense to have two separate, you know, programs. So it's actually really good timing. A note on the pop-up park at Selma and Ivar. We are continuing some data collection from that initial kickoff event that we had. We got about 50 responses from people using the park, and we've been visiting the farmers market on Sunday where the park is most actively used and getting some more feedback. So last Sunday we got about another 40 responses, and we're going to do one more session this upcoming Sunday to bump up our numbers to hopefully 60 to 70 responses total. So once we're finished with that, I'm going to compile a report and share those findings with the board just to see what the public thinks of the park, if they thought it was successful, what could be improved if it was, you know, to be done differently, things like that. So
the park is very well kept. It's not being vandalized.
Yeah, it's been great. We've got a lot of good feedback so far. Contract update with Street Plus. I'm happy to report that things are going well. We have our operation system in full motion, so we're now able to log into a database and confirm that work is being done. We, as Joe mentioned, we will have some savings next year of about $75,000, and we'll be talking with the Streetscape Committee at the end of the month as to how we should spend that money. Based on, you know, staff observation and conversations with our maintenance crew, and also based on, you know, complaints from stakeholders, we've got kind of three options that we're looking at in how to spend that money. That would include increasing some pressure washing for Zone 1. Right now, Sunset and Vine is only being pressure washed once a month, which simply is not enough. So that could be a way to spend the money. Also, adding another porter to sweep litter, and also another round of trash collection. Right now, we do it twice a day, and we could potentially do that three times a day with that money. So those are the options we're considering right now. So if you wanted to provide input on that, we'll be talking at the Streetscape Committee on the 30th, so you're welcome to join. And then just a note on the tree walls. We are going to have an intern going out to survey the streets and identify tree walls that are low on decomposed granite, so that we can get an estimate to refill those wells in an effort to alleviate some trip hazards out there for pedestrians.
And Carrie, can you talk about this, right?
Yes, we had an intern from Italy this summer.
Not good.
Went out for, I don't know, 3 or 4 days, walked up and down every single street in both bids, and took a picture of every dilapidated news rack that he could find, which was humongous. Did a beautiful chart. This hopefully will be a college essay for him. And took a picture. We submitted that to the Board of Public Works, because if you look at the news racks in our city, they are just not being enforced. And found 86 of the news racks. Most of them LA Express, which is the foreign paper, and Working World. LA Express just has stopped putting covers on their news racks, basically, and they turn into trash receptacles. We've got pictures of people throwing in paper cups. So we submitted that to the Board of Public Works because the city is not enforcing the news rack ordinance. And there's actually the BIDs in the city have had a long history in the past with seeking news rack enforcement, because they can really be a blight on the community. And about 10 years ago, we all came together for a couple of years and got all the news racks in the city transformed into one color, the olive green that you see, with very specific requirements. You could not have more than 4 in a row, and then there had to be a space, because sometimes there were, you know, dozens and dozens of news racks kind of crammed into various corners. But what's interesting is that with the decline in the publishing industry, there's been a diminution of the number of news racks out there for you know, publishers like the LA Times and the Daily News and USA Today, etc. So I met with some of the public works commissioners and pointed out to them, I managed to go back to the original council report. Back in 2009, when they set the per news rack fee for placing a news rack, your annual fee, the board of the public works staff wanted the fee to be $40 a news rack. And at that time, there were 23,000 news racks in the city. And that was the amount of money that the staff thought would be necessary for them to be able to go out and enforce news racks. The publisher's industry was incredibly, had a very powerful lobby at that time, and they kept that price at $26 a news rack, and that price has not increased since. So that number was low to begin with, and now the city has estimated that there's less than half the number of news racks as there were back in 2009. So the cool thing about this little project is that it's sparking a conversation about revisiting how the city's going to enforce the news rack law, possibly raising the fee. What they did agree to do with the 86 that we submitted was come out and they tagged them. And I've been meaning to go out and see if I can see these tags so that if it's an abandoned rack, after 10 days, the rack will be taken away. They'll take the racks out. And if after 10 days, the publisher does not fix the rack or put the top on or clean it up, it also will be taken away. So we're kind of right in the midst of that process right now. But yeah, so it was a great little project.
Yeah.
And
but didn't we discuss there were some lots of illegal racks as opposed to the legal racks you're describing?
Well, that's where I think the city has kind of had a hard time because racks will mysteriously show up on a sidewalk.
Right.
And it's hard to imagine that there's truly a permit for those.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, it's probably very likely that a lot of racks have been installed that do not have permits at all. But with this exercise, they'll be tagged, and if there's no permit, they will be taken out.
Yeah,
so we're going to encourage all the bids to do a similar project.
Also, those racks have been there for a long time. The sidewalks are really in bad shape, so not only take them away, but also I think, because there have been like 20 racks before.
Right.
They'll
have holes in the.
Yeah.
The good news is that the Walk of Fame is not allowed to have any news racks on it. So somehow the chamber in their wisdom many years ago said that you could not bolt news racks into the terrazzo. Thank goodness.
You know, Carrie, years ago when the whole enforcement thing happened, it wasn't as much of a financial issue. And I think now we don't have enough money to enforce many things, and it's priority.
Right. I think the recovery cost would probably be $200 a news rack or something now. They're really trying to, let's say we're down to 15,000 news racks in the city. It'd be interesting to see what they come back with us, their recovery cost.
All right. So, Devin, tell us where the next party is.
Sure. So we're looking for a location for next year. Some of the locations we've been talking about are the Palladium parking lot, the rooftop deck of the Arclight parking structure, and the rooftop deck of the LA Film School parking structure. So we want to get information about those locations and maybe a couple more, and hopefully by next month we'll have all that for you so that we can kind of move forward with the location and hopefully a date or a time frame.
That's what
sounds good. But it's not
going
to be as late as September?
Well, it definitely is not going to be Labor Day weekend. Anywhere around there, but as far as whether it's going to be spring or fall, we're not totally sure.
You know, Malibu, they have Labor Day, Big Day Carnival, and it's like the most popular thing in all of Malibu for those 3 days. Everybody comes to that just to experience.
Yeah, there's a lot of things out of town and in different parts of town on Labor Day weekend, and I think it's a little competitive that weekend, so I think we have problems that. This particular last year because of that.
So no September, is that what you're saying? No September?
If it was September, it'd probably be later in the month.
Later in the month,
yeah.
Okay. Infographics, I know we're spending some money there.
Yeah, we've met with Haynes and Co. to start brainstorming on what the new infographics will look like. And I believe we're in the process of making an RFP for a research firm. Is that correct, Joe?
Yes.
Yeah. So we're going to do some research on the impacts of the bid that we can put into a easy to understand infographic form, similar to the ones that we did, the Hollywood infographics that we did a couple of years ago.
To tell the stakeholder all the improvement that the bid has been doing.
Exactly.
The streetscape cars that we own, can we advertise on those?
Yeah, that's a work in progress. We were trying to get just kind of stabilized and the routes all down before we take any vehicles out to do branding. But we will be repainting the vehicles and putting our logos on all of our
equipment. Sponsored by the Hollywood bid or the Sponsor.
Yeah, they'll have our district logos for each.
Yep. Yeah, we were just, like Matthew said, just waiting to have them get accustomed to their routes. And then just briefly, as Devin mentioned, the RFP that we sent out is in your packet for the economic study. It is a page on the back that shows. And there's six firms that we sent it to, our individuals. So we thank you to Lauren for getting that out last week, and that's all in there if you'd like to see it. That's that.